Hi.
Hi. Was denn die So, to
Thank you for the invite, and it's a pleasure to be here with the Public Affairs Committee. So as we talk about Colombia, I'm sure you guys have recently heard has been tracking the significant growth that the Colombian parliamentary has been experiencing. And I think it's contributing to a lot of different things that have happened over the last several years. And tracking it from FY20, which was when we kicked off the shifting of the non-CT traders to Colombia, you know, immediately we saw a significant increase, roughly 1,000 containers that would normally would have crossed to the trade bridge overnight shifted to the Colombia bridge. And as you know, what it provided was some relief to the World Trade Bridge. And of course, it provided some volumes to Colombia. Prior to that change, Colombia was processing approximately 1,300 to 1,500 troops daily. Of course, with that shift, we jumped to over 2,000 trucks, very consistently. On top of that initiative, we were also working, internally with a lot of importers and stakeholders, primarily in the agriculture, the perishable industry. Being that Colombia was equipped like World Trade with the programs that the Civil Radio invested in back in 2012. Well, quickly, we found out that the capacity of those programs was already at maximum. We actually had importers that were having to wait several hours just to get their turn inside the refrigerated units to get their products inspected. And of course, the city, working with the private entity that manages the programs, built this offsite, this facility, which has attracted a lot of the business to the Colombia Bridge. So that also has led to the increase in volumes of Colombia. If we look at our numbers back in 2020, we were pushing about 382,000 trucks at the time, at the end of that fiscal year. In that following fiscal year, we increased to 636,000 trucks, which is roughly represents about 60% increase from the previous year. When you look at FY22, we went from 636,000 trucks to 708,000 trucks. And closing out this last fiscal year, we processed over 750,000 trucks at Colombia, 759,000 trucks. Now, if you look at FY23 and compare it to FY20, we increased our volumes at Colombia by 98%. We feel that we're going to continue seeing the growth of Colombia for various reasons. And of course, we all know, and we're tracking the projects that Governor Murillo has very aggressively been pursuing to have this state compete. And our concern is, of course, the completion of the roadway. Right now, we've seen this growth without even having that roadway completed. And again, 98% is quite significant in a 3-year period. And just to imagine once that roadway completes, I think we're going to see Colombia explode probably to the point where we're probably going to be seeing the same amount of congestion and wait times that we were seeing at World Trade Bridge. Colombia, as you know, back in was built in 1991. No major infrastructures, projects to Colombia have been made. We still have the same eight lanes that we had in the facility first opened. Now, that facility was built for about 4,000, 4,500 trucks capacity. Right now, because of initiative that we have working with the government of Mexico, we actually gave up one of our families to have an armed officer work side by side with officers in this part of our unified payroll processing. But realistically, we have seven processing lanes. If you look at our processing capacity, we can probably push 4,000 trucks and we'll be at capacity. So we're about 2,800 right now. And it depends the day of the week, the time of the year, sometimes we're hitting 3,000 trucks, which is unheard of. That's what in North Bay, yes. So our ask, of course, is going to be processing capacity. And what that means is literally some boots. We're looking at Colombia. We do have some real estate that we can probably, in a short-term project, possibly do the same thing we did at the World Trade Bridge, where we use that open land in the middle of the outbound booths and the northbound, and build out that project. You know, that is a possibility in the short term to maybe build out some additional areas, in that empty space at Colombia. Right now, we are processing ride loads. As you know, Colombia does have some traffic for oversized cargo, but we actually use a dirt road right now. So we can build up possibly some booths to accommodate that cargo. And of course, if we can do it, we do a trade, we can usually push a fast cargo that is using Colombia right now. That's about 400 to 500 trucks right now. And of course, every day we're increasing our participation and we're hoping to build that volume, that universal project from Central Colombia. But of course, we have our UCP program that we also work with in Colombia. Again, looking at Colombia, you do have a rather large footprint that we can possibly put maybe some three cargo lanes. Since you're asking, we also feel that once the Loria Railway is finished, I see a lot of people, that live primarily in Monterey, that right now use Bridge 2 as a crossing point for tourists and visits for visiting, including that they're going to use TMB. Right now, we only have four booths to process passenger vehicles. We already experienced it during a peak travel time, where we have significant wait times at Columbia for passenger vehicles. So maybe some passenger booths as well to accommodate passenger vehicle volumes to Columbia. Which, when I'm really happy that many of the bridge is taken after all these years, and it had been desolate for the first years and stuff, and then the things were working, especially the first roads and things like that. Right now, the capacity, so you're about 2,850 a day that capacity, and it could take up to 4,000.
The maximum would be
about 4,000. Would you think that there's going to be, when is your projection for that to be it?
So if our growth continues, again, looking at it, of course, the big increase was that after we moved the anchor, we saw that 60% increase over a year. Looking at other circumstances, comparing this year to last year, we grew 7%. So we're consistent. We probably hit 4,000. We're going to do it. And that's not even counting the Loria road. That's the concern. Once that road completes, you can see how we're shifting real trade to Colombia. And I know there's a lot of factors involved for cargo to ship from Mexico to another, primarily on the Mexican side. But again, it just depends. Whether that immediate shift would happen once the road gets complete, or it's going to be progressive.
You're going to get us on the tourism tour. They're going to be using that. Most of the people that are using that.
Yes, sir.
What are you sure that it's going to happen? Well, we have 30% of the case right now, everybody's negotiating plans. It takes 18, 20 months for them to build. And they're all building every month. When they open, they're going to open. And right now, nobody's opening new manufacturers. So they're building them and coming for the next 18, 24 months. And 500 more trucks a month out from today. In 6 months, that increment is going to happen at the 80% that we're able to look at the year. But is it going to happen in 2 years or 4? I don't know. anything that can happen, then it can happen. And if you need to, you need to.
Are you ready to do it? You could be,
So UCP is roughly about 400 plus building that are using the UCP.
And you see, because of the case, the consideration that has to be approved in this inside. We need that explanation, would it be something which from city group, or if you also create a particular local representative?
As far as.
Getting the explanation, the city official.
So again, short term would be, you know, what we did at Rotary, which is the DAP, you know, the DAP was a little painful process, but it was our first project. Well, you know, took roughly about 6 years ready to, so many, but I think, short of going a full blown expansion, you know, which would take a lot more time and more people involved. I think short term would be possibly build something out through the DAP program. And you already have the real estate there between, you know, the city of Laredo, Auburn, Purvis, and your primary booths, so you have the real estate. And we have the roadways, you know, we've got a big piece of real estate there that's a straight shot to the main road that leads out to Main Trail.
This allows me to prepare a plan so that come February, when we start working on the budget, this is when we will do. We can present this plan and we can get the funding in place based on many recommendations, even with recommendations, and we can that's going to be cool. So,
Giving the motion for that.
Not yet.
I mean, you gotta put something on right now anyway, because it's coming.
So, again, in addition to building out the capacity, there would be, of course, not getting too much into the weeds, but just kind of looking, you know, looking south from our primary booths, there will definitely have to be some realignment in the actual bridge span as far as the number of lanes. You know that we probably see a lot more coming into the US and actually going into Mexico. So, you know, knowing that, and I don't know, anticipating, I don't know how much growth going south would occur in the next several years, but we definitely would probably have to add some lanes coming with them as opposed to having to split. You have 404, right? You have right now? You told me? Yes. So instead of 4 southbound, maybe during times of the day, you might expand to maybe 6. Well, that at least can be something that could be coordinated, you know, through the bridge system, where you have that flexibility to go from 4 to 6, and then when you do see increase out of the sun going south, then you can take 4 back.
Are the southbound numbers the same increase?
They have a higher number northbound because they're forcing all the MTs to come in from there. Versus us going southbound, they can go to the greater day. So the numbers are not going to match because of the MTs. Not speaking of MTs.
This is the question of the biggest federation number. So you're recommending.
We make that recommendation right now for the Thursday, hey, during peak hours, and it's lighting for the traffic and for the
committee action. We've worked together, PVP and myself, We do it during Christmas, we do it during Holy Week, and as they see a need, then we put the delineator post and we give them more lanes and we should meet ours. We work hand in hand with the city, so there's no need for a motion. Suggestion, we already do.
Neither.
We'll make the motion.
The fact that we have now about 4,000 trucks, one of the current infrastructure, we would add again some of the scanners, some pre-primary rank, but I was too afraid of that thing when you're two, when you get those done and some other things, as far as efficiency, how much would that increase the expenses?
It'll definitely make us a lot more efficient.
Would that increase expenses too?
Well, I think, give us a little bit of capacity, knowing that, you know, you're probably gonna be pushing those trucks from the booth to the gate, because that we're gonna be scanning with the trucks coming in, so they'll buy some time.
Well, again, that is, if there's only so much efficiency within the bond, it's put into the jail, but we're gonna have to make it physically expand, so that's what we're gonna do today, looking into the future, so we're starting to do it.
Do you think, actually, you can play like we do, you know, right with it?
So again, short term, yes, short term. If it continues to grow, then again, it'll be nice to have two big bridges, you know, processing that much further. But, you know, I've seen plans where they're having about adding another bridge. Are we there yet? Possibly, maybe not today, but just not knowing what's gonna happen once that roadway opens, how much of that new shoring is actually gonna be, you know, coming at us.
We would expect it for the road to be ready.
The end of the year, January?
Really already.
And it's why the staff, I mean, we need to cover for the, you know.
So you can never ask anybody, you say that, I don't need staff.
Your official answer?
No.
I know it is, but.
In all honesty, I think the port.
Becoming a problem.
I think the port is in good position in this situation. You know, Congressman Goyette has done very well in keeping us, you know, where we need to be. And we're constantly getting people. You know, there's a big date coming up for us, 2028, when a big number of us are eligible to retire, and they're already planning for that. We're seeing a lot of new blood coming in.
We have to keep pushing to that.
Oh, yeah, that has to be a constant message to the congressman and everyone to continue, you know, keeping the staffing levels.
Well, you know that before you know it, we're gonna have to be in 28 for the time soon and the RFE. But, you know, if we haven't been able to expand the rail trade, I mean, we need to do something right away to put something in and make that motion to get it done today. You know, and push your council to get it done if that's what that city would need.
We do have issues.
I tell you what, we take the problem home.
You don't take it home.
Yeah, it's a good time. Special government company, we're gonna look into where we can.
Yes, we even if we were to experience a shutdown, we're prepared to keep clean inside. I'm gonna say it's fortunate, unfortunate, but, you know, gun carrying issues were considered essential. And we will keep, you know, operations going as we're ready.
It's been years.
Oh, yeah. We keep going.
Everything with.
We keep going.
Eventually, everything would be paid.
Yes. No, actually, you know, we did have a lot of support here locally from some institutions that were very open and willing to assist in the schools, you know, financially. If we had the food bank, you know, just messaging that there's, you know, things available for our employees. So, and someone took, you know, advantage of those, and but yeah.
The biggest concern is not customers, because there's now the fit essential to keep you
Right now, I'm initially working with him as an opposite to the chief. So, we're wearing, I think, the form. We also learned from the meeting plan to issue with the meeting.
See any more of the inspections?
I would defer to my DPS friends, but you know, they're really good about communicating. And I know sometimes, you know, business is really what people when they hear about committees, safety inspections, but you know, from a notification standpoint, you know, prior to them actually starting to India, we had done the notification, you know, the day before, letting us know, you know, here locally on the ground. Great working relationship, you know, with Texas DPS and for that matter with all our, you know, agency, whatever here at the foot. But again, it's just like us, you know, we get the new routine orders and we got to do what they have to do. But no really indication of them either starting them up at Columbia. I know the questions came up about them doing at World Trade. Yeah, World Trade, I don't think they have a footprint inside the extra, I mean, the exit gates to do something safely. So we don't see World Trade as an area that they would do in. I think Columbia, they would do it again. Columbia would really be that location.
Thank you.
Well, I'd like to make the motion that the budget that we're going to, are you going to build up the budget or we're going to, we're just going to, for the expansion or the need of an expansion? Or look into it, that's better, and what is that you should do?
Okay, for now, during the office, to be part of the meeting, you will be directed to move forward with the expansion of Columbia. We have since received a proposal. And it's a little real with the city manager to say they want to move forward with the engineering proposal or put it out on bids. Based on our consultants that are doing the expansion at World Trade, they are advising the city to move forward and submitting a presidential permit application so that this process can go in hand with the legislation that our congressmen are taking up in Washington, so that this expansion can also go in there so that we can gain presidential permit quicker. So that's where the city, where we're working at, working with engineering, that's where we're at right now to get the target. All the other infrastructure that we talked about can be worked with them as we did the fast lanes donation acceptance project at World Trade. It's still a process, but it's quicker than the process for the presidential term. So, you can entertain a motion, but that's our
information.
Who owns the property on the outside of the city or is it doesn't private?
The more signs of it, you know, regarding flats and areas of the city, we try to make it very quick.
Those
in the
I think the focus of the range of units is doing the sun, you know, where it's going over. If I may, so we do need a presidential unit for expansion.
Yeah.
But that's only something maybe in the region.
Yeah, on the bridge, not on.
On the bridge, on the bridge, sorry.
They're not in the federal facilities.
But we're gonna need that other.
Yes. Presidential permit will be needed.
Rachel, you should be here. Take care.
Yeah, we made it. One minute.
See you here and you're not here for it. Always asked to reserve land, but you know, if you know, the private owners, so we can dedicate everything. Even in World Trade, would you ask?
There's
I'm sorry, the whole rock. Can you hear us?
Yes, we can. I can. Good morning.
Move on to the next item, discussion of possible action. I did this. charging dynamic fee on all commercial spaces. This item.
Before we lower anything or we discuss that, that's why we wanted Mr. Inoza to give us some education of bringing down prices on toll fees with the bridge. Mr. Inoza, you have the floor, sir.
Well, I guess, can you hear me?
Perfect.
Great. I guess it's good to be put on the spot, I guess. Good morning, it's 10 o'clock. I guess I had a call from Yvette, I guess must have been yesterday, the day before yesterday, probably yesterday, I guess Monday. And there apparently some interest on your part to attempt to reduce rates at one of the bridges or maybe the entire system. But my understanding is that you want to find a way on how, I guess, stimulate crossings and alleviate traffic congestion at one of the bridges and bring it over to move some of that traffic over to Columbia. And as you may know, and I'm sure you do know, the city has had this system of tolls for many, many, many years. I would say at least 40, 45, where every single bridge crossing has had the same rate at either 1 and 2, and then ultimately Columbia and then World Trade Bridge. And over time, the lender representative, which happens to be a third party, a rating agency called either Moody's, Standard & Poor's, or Fitch, they assign a qualification or a credit rating to whenever the city borrows money. And it not only borrows money for the bridge system, it borrows money for infrastructure that the city needs to address from time to time, vis-a-vis buying equipment for various departments within the city, making improvements of roads, and so on and so forth. So the city, we've been honored to represent them for about 30 plus years. At one time, the city had a rating of a Baa1. So think of you and I going to the bank. And if you happen to have $10 million in assets, the loan officer is probably going to treat you better as if I go to the bank and I have nothing. So the same goes across the country, where Laredo has a rating, and I believe it's in the AA category. And when we first started working with the city, they were at a Baa category. Mexico, as a sovereign country, is, I believe, still an A. The state of Nuevo León, any sub-sovereign political subdivisions inside of Mexico are in the non-investment grade category. So you are, the highest rating is a AAA. The United States of America used to have a AAA, I believe, now it's a AA1, depending who you ask. It's either AAA or AA in the high category. Laredo is right at a AA2, I believe. And what that does is, like anything, we can be modest in the way we conduct ourselves, but we do it with a very disciplined approach to borrowing money. So despite a lot of changes in a very vibrant economy that is exposed to peso devaluations, that is exposed to international relations and so on and so forth, Laredo has managed over many years to keep that AA credit. So the bridge system is a component of bridge of revenues to the city. So if the bridge were to borrow money, very likely, unlike in many years before, the city can actually use banks that are sponsored by the state of Texas, or sometimes even sponsored by the federal government through the Federal Highway Administration or through TxDOT. And when you use those banks, there are heavily subsidized interest rates. So most recently, whenever we borrow money for the bridge, we have used those tools or those options in an effort to reduce the interest cost to the city. But what's important here is that when you change a structure of collection of rates, that will ultimately affect the city, and that bridge system revenues represent, I want to say, probably about 15%, 1/5 of total revenues of the city. The biggest revenue source for the city is property taxes. So if you live in Laredo, you pay property taxes, big chunk of that goes to the city general fund. A second or third component of revenue is going to be sales tax. And third is either bridge. And sometimes they go back and forth. Okay? So the city today, I want to say, probably has a budget just in general fund operations, paying police, paying fire, of about $200 million. And I'm just kind of on a macro picture. I haven't seen the numbers recently, but it's somewhere in there. The bridge system generates about $70 to $75 million, and as you have seen, being the advisory group to the city council, you've seen revenues rise. Not long ago, I want to say about 4, 5, or 6 years ago, I think the crossings at World Trade Bridge were just shy of 6,500 thereabouts, and now I've been told that they're 8,500. So that's a pretty compelling number, and seems like your concerns are pretty valid. I think one of the concerns we have is that if you were to make the effort of changing tolls, let's say at Columbia, but not at World Trade Bridge, we will be concerned about the dislocation of traffic flow. How many of those trucks will go from World Trade Bridge to Columbia? And if you were to reduce the tolls, what would that impact be in regards to revenues? And you have to take into account revenues generated by current crossings and then additional crossings. And that's not something that we're equipped to give you any numbers. We can be speculative, but there are consultants out there that can conduct probably a survey in telling you and giving us an origin and destination study as to, hey, what if we were to reduce the rate? And then what percent of that rate decrease would you be interested in do it? Or, you know, you don't get to the AA credit by just with the power of the pen, say, I'm going to move rates from this to that, and we'll see where we land. It's not very common. I mean, we represent, if you come to Dallas, where I'm at right now, we represent the North Texas Toll Road Authority. We represent Cameron County down in Brownsville. And a lot of times you hire rate consultants to give the financial industry that has supported you in the past, that supports the city in doing projects, capital projects for their everyday operations. The rate agencies and financial industry will expect you to have some sort of a study that tells us, okay, this is what would be the effect if you were to do this. And unfortunately, sometimes that's what the industry requires. On the other hand, if you feel like, no, we feel like we can go from this price to this other price, let's try it out. Then, as you and I know, only the city council can make those changes through your advice, and you know, we just have to see where that ends in terms of, if you make a change, you know, what will be the impact on revenues. I think one of the concerns of the city, well, I guess I'll stop right there and entertain any questions you may have.
So the question is a dynamic fee. It's only for a couple of hours. You lower it or you increase it and you bring it back to where it's at. And so that's, it would affect the credit for the city or not, that's really our.
I don't think it would. I don't think that it would, and I'm assuming you're the chairman of the board?
I'm here.
You're at the head table, so.
No, I think the thing is, I think also is checking the impact of how it's gonna affect the rating as far as what is it net of what they owe on the bonds that they've acquired, right? And what is excess that's going into the general fund? And what is that excess that's going to the general fund that'll affect the general fund that goes in, but it doesn't disrupt the service of servicing the debt that they have based on the, what the bridge has gotten loans on or gotten their expansion loans for. The other thing is if it does, then you amortize it, you know, for a further period. But I think there's still some, I'm sure there's still some revenues going into the general fund that I think that's where it's gonna really offset and not hit our rating, because you're only talking about only a specific time and not for doing it permanently, whether you increase it or you lower it.
And then you heard how many trucks were crossing southbound, total or credit?
That's Columbia.
That's Columbia. I mean, we're talking only about Columbia, we're not, they didn't give us.
So maybe, yeah, maybe the thing that I should hear from you, what is your proposal? I mean, the debt of the bridge system today is de minimis. In other words, it's not that significant. The bridge debt is absolutely very little debt. There are projects in mind that will probably double or triple the current condition of the system's debt. What you have to keep in mind is that this system belongs to the city. And right or wrong, over time, the city has significantly relied on these bridge revenues. So any changes to those revenues, whether they're upward or downward, the rating agencies normally don't react to whether you make any changes at the bridge system in terms of toll collections until revenues have been registered. So if, for example, you were to adopt a rate change and that rate change, instead of generating a $30 million transfer to the city and it becomes $28 million or it becomes $27 million, then in the eyes of the rating agencies, they're not going to react to that change from one year to the next. It's normally a trend. It takes 2 or 3 years for them to see what the purpose is of this action of reducing those rates. And at the end of the day, if those revenues are affected, then you would expect that the lender, who, by the way, the city has close to $900 million worth of debt outstanding. And of that 900 million, about 500 or 600 is water and sewer revenue debt. 300 million is what we call in our business property tax supported and enterprise supported. We have the bridge, we have landfill, we have other enterprises that help the city pay off debt that is borrowed by the city for the benefit of those enterprises. But there's no question that we all recognize it, that the city enjoys of the transfers from the bridge system over to the general fund. And if you want to make changes, then the one that concerns us most is going to be the city's credit rating, meaning the general obligation debt of the city. But I don't think for what you're proposing, if I hear you correctly, is that you want to put in place a dynamic fee, as I was told by Yvette yesterday, that it will be during certain hours, kind of like in Dallas. If I use a highway and I want to go in a peak hour from Dallas to Frisco, I want to have what is called managed lanes. In fact, we have LBJ 635 here, where you basically take a managed lane, and depending on the hour, they charge you more. So I'd be interested to learn more about your proposal on this dynamic fee.
Will it affect the, well, you know, we don't know what the number is in a way, but the debt service coverage, I'm sure that we're pretty much high.
The debt service, Yeah, there is absolutely no impact on the credit rating of the bridge revenue bonds, absolutely none.
Okay.
What I'm more concerned about is two things, is the general debt, and two, your ability to borrow money for future projects, vis-a-vis expansion of World Trade Bridge, and other bridges that are being considered at the city. But from what I'm hearing.
Fact is, we're gonna find out with that dollar line.
The question I have, Mr. Nolasa, is what if we just did a master, we didn't lower the rates, but when we did this dynamic fee, it's only, it increases a little bit at one or increases a lot more at another, that way encouraging the traffic to go to the lower fee, but it's, we're not gonna drop below anything that we currently have. So raise it a little bit, that way we can maintain all our income that we're anticipating, doesn't affect our ratings. But this pilot, we're just putting a mask over what we have by a little bit of an increase or more of an increase, right? So that we can, what we're talking about, encourage these more traffic, so that we leave congestion at World Trade Bridge to send them to Columbia during peak hours, only raise it a little bit at Columbia and raise it more at World Trade.
And that's what we're trying to do as a.
Yeah, it's, I think we're, can you go back to the original?
Send the trucks a certain.
Correct, it's an incentive to do that.
Can you, no, it's not an incentive, no, of course not, no, I'm afraid, can we, there's no, we're just talking like, we're in kindergarten, we're bringing ideas to. It's, and it's, first of all, you mentioned this is only for Columbia, I was gonna, can you bring some background on this item as?
It was, that Mr. Gonzalez at that meeting, the Dr. Gonzalez there, mentioned that he was gonna lower his price starting, I think he said November.
First, he was gonna lower his price, northbound by 50%.
Okay.
But that's a 50%, that's what he said. But that doesn't mean that the city can follow what they're following, right?
Yeah.
The recommendation was brought up that if we could accommodate and do the same thing, so that's why I come to this.
Yeah, so if you're gonna, this is, I'm gonna talk about Columbia, no World Trade Bridge at all. So it costs about from $45 to $75 extra to go to Columbia for any reason, that's what the drayage companies charge, transfer charge. We charge, Columbia charges $22, $25 per crossing. I don't know what the ticket cost is.
It's the same price.
No, yeah, but $22, $25.
$4.55 per axle.
It's the same price.
It's the same.
But also, no, I know, say, the total is $22, $25. So are you gonna go to zero and save that person? She's still gonna have to pay $22, $25 extra to, instead of World Trade, he's not gonna, the reason going to Columbia is very different. They're still paying more and we're still using Columbia. Well, for, when I use Columbia, I use it for another reason, that the cost reason is not there. So bringing the cost down, $2, $5, you know, you're not gonna offset the $45, $60 extra that a truck charges to cross through there. So I think that will not move the needle to Columbia. It's other things that move, other necessities, you know, traffic jams, and you've got 2-3 hours across. If it's hazmat, if your warehouse, if your trucking company is on that side, I don't know what other reasons, you know, people that on the southbound use Columbia. So I don't know, but you guys, you know, what do you think about Columbia decreasing, gonna increase the southbound volume? If you decrease it or so that's kind of like what I'm saying is. Marcos, I think he's going back, he's doing a sale for his companies in Nuevo León, from, hey, you use us, but let me get the volume, and then he's gonna move trucking companies to be in that area, whatever, and create that volume. And he's like giving that to his constituents and industries in Nuevo León in a bigger volume. So I don't think that exists here to use that difference.
And is that gonna get us at a capacity, I'm sorry, is that gonna get us at that capacity faster? Also, if they're gonna be.
Well, we're talking about southbound and they're talking about northbound, so it's very different capacities.
But I think he's using combination, because Dr. Marcos is only working on northbound level, on the dollar amount. And the one thing that he did, you break it down in segments, in the morning is minimal crossing. Noontime to 4, I think that's where the big volume is, so he's trying to draw that from there down to the bottom by reducing the fees. So it's gonna be targeting the same market area.
But the one thing that we gotta work on is based on the bureaucratic numbers or process we have to go through, we have to go out there and do studies and so forth to see if we can go forward. When it's a common sense approach, if we go out there and say, give us how much you make per hour, I mean, per 2 or 3 hours, and we just kind of divide that number up and say, well, this will be the value. If we drop it a certain amount, maybe we could get more money based on increased volume, and it would be a factor, but then we have to try. Because if we don't try, just look at the numbers.
But it's just the cost.
Yeah.
What are you gonna drop it at zero?
No, but.
No. It'd be just to match Nola rate.
But what Milo is telling is there's no reason, like, for Mexican brokers to send a shipment to Colombia for like $10 that you are gonna save during the hours.
Yeah, but we're not asking it. We're asking to draw from the noon time to the morning time. It's on the same bridge, and maybe it attracts some other individuals. So you're targeting the same market area to reduce that amount from noon to in the morning.
Sure.
So it's the same. So it's the same. The tart market, and then if you get World Trade Bridge,
but
it's a plus.
But Colombia's not saturated right now.
At noon, from they wait.
No, southbound
from noon to four. That's when the volumes. They're trying to draw from that to the morning.
But I don't.
And that was a comment that was made. I don't know. You can sit there and elaborate on that if you want.
One other thing.
No, go ahead.
But the market is for Colombia is half a mile. So it doesn't affect the World Trade Bridge. It affects only Colombia.
The only way it could affect World Trade Bridge is if they see that number and they say, you know what, it's a benefit for me because the line's shorter, so I'm going to use that line as well. So, but that's just if we had camped.
Yeah. But I don't know, lately on the hazmat, the time that I use Colombia, I don't experience any like big lines. So to me, it doesn't matter right now. Like
the dynamic
is not going to work. It's not going to attract me to like submit anything, because on the other hand, I'm subject to receive the money from the Mexican customer in order for me to pay and send them to Mexico.
It's not on my hands.
And usually I cannot schedule for the following day.
Yeah, the market's telling you now.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you're talking about new business.
I would like to ask for clarification of what the purpose of all this.
Yeah.
If it's to, you know, bring, you know,
to match
the hours or between Laredo and Colombia. To move traffic from Laredo to Colombia, or to move traffic from noon to the low hours.
The first answer was to match Dr. Gonzalez's proposal. That was it. Was to be the same.
If we could do something, let me
tell you, Dr. Gonzalez, he doesn't care about noon or mornings or whatever. He's trying to sell the bridge as a whole. As a whole option, and that's his job, and he's doing a good job. But I mean, what are we trying to do here? That's the first question, because we're all over the place with Laredo, Colombia. I mean, what are we trying to do? That would be the first question that I would like to be.
So, well, our objective was, if we decrease, would it affect, or can we match it or not? And so they brought it to this table to see what our recommendation is. But we have a lot of things, not just lowering the price. And so that's what we're discussing. Mr. Moore?
So I just wanted to say that we brought this issue up a few months ago when we were working with the Mines Road and we were trying to alleviate the congestion over there, to say, how can we entice people to move from World Trade Bridge to Colombia so that we can alleviate some of the congestion that we were experiencing at the time at World Trade Bridge, on Mines Road particularly. And so would we raise the price a little bit at World Trade Bridge, and then lower it a little bit at raise it at one and lower it the other one, so it becomes a net really for charging the same overall, because the whole idea is we're not changing the volume so much, we're just moving some of the volume over here.
Exactly.
And so that was really the goal of why we started it. This brought it back up on the deal today. It had to do with Marcos, right? But all in all, as a city, we need to start looking at the bigger picture. Is how can we alleviate congestion? Because we already know, based on even with Bert here this morning, that we need to look at expansion of Colombia. We're going to be at capacity of World Trade Bridge before too long with the volumes and the growth that we're seeing. So how can we entice that to alleviate or balance out some of these volumes and alleviate the congestion?
And it would surprise me, if I may, you know, when you talk about the dynamic fee, it could be called congestion fee too. I mean, this is putting pressure on operations for the city by either having more police officers, transit officers, the roads are being you know, affected too. So there's a lot of things. I see a lot of benefit on that side too. So somebody said earlier about the common sense approach, you know, I would go slowly, like you would do if it was your business, if you're going to make a change, to see how that evolves, how that trend evolves.
So, you know, so using that example, wouldn't it be more beneficial to say, okay, keep the prices the same, but at those peak hours, raise the prices?
Just keep them the same and raise them.
Yes, so keep those same prices from 12 to 4, raise those prices.
So if you're going to use World Trade Bridge, payment
would be less than what we were already making.
Got it.
There's two ways to look at it. Is that you can keep the same price, and then at the hours you want them across, you lower it, which doesn't sound beneficial. Or you can keep the same price, and at the hours you don't want them across, you raise the price.
The thing about raising price with the government, they want to keep the price. You don't want to start a pilot program. It's permanent. You know,
well, if you lower it, you might end up stuck at that price also.
Yeah, for farm, it's a pilot program, so you sit there, establish a
pilot program. Pilot program for up and down and
so what?
As a financial advisor to the city, I'd rather you do raise the rates on the peak hours than not. But
it's easier to go back down.
And then under the public sector, nobody wants anybody to raise the price.
These rates
That's right.
are approved by council through an ordinance. So we can't just try it and see if it works.
Yeah.
If we take it to council and it's adopted,
so it's not a pilot.
It won't be a pilot.
It's not a pilot.
It will stay like that until
somebody else knocks it down.
Yeah. And I've been with the bridge for 21 years. We've never lowered rates.
Yeah, yeah.
We increase.
It's a slippery slope that I don't think.
Then lowering. So
being involved in this organization. For the last 22 years, we've been talking about reducing prices. Yes. And I remember one of our first meetings whenever the Blue Ribbon, they discussed it, and the city's always against any reduction. The city's always for raising prices. Yes. But this was brought up just because of the meeting that Mr. Rodriguez held that was proposed just during the time frame, because the fact is Metzco's doing it. And we said, hey, maybe we can match just during this time frame. But that's just a proposal, and that's for discussion here and see where we end up.
But they're very desperate for business to boom that bridge, and it's 50% is crazy.
Yeah. So there's no benefit on the short term. My suggestion is wait for the Gloria road to be completed, and we'll see how your business reacts.
Business and the saturation and all that.
Wait from there. Go from there. So. I won't take that bait from Dr. Gonzalez. Just leave it as it is and go from there.
Because any lower of the rate is going to lower revenue. And that's what the city doesn't want for the general fund or for whatever to service their debt, because then they're going to have to increase in another area, you know, to get this revenue.
The main point is to move the flow from later time to an earlier. And the only way to do that is to give them an incentive to move it earlier.
And
I don't suggest reducing it. I suggest.
The incentive is already there, but automatically it's
on the main
time. The wait time. It's anybody could manage that in their everybody paying that extra indirectly. If it's costing more time to get a truck in and come back for the other one,
yeah.
If you start at 8 a.m. and you can move more truck between 8 and 12, you start at 12. You take longer hours to move your 30, 40, 50, 60 trucks. The incentive is already there, I guess, indirectly or not in a direct money savings, but it's there. If you get your freight out early, you're moving it faster between 8 and 12.
Now, why does it come out later? Why? Because we don't start at 7 or 8 in the morning. We all know that we started later on.
No, you can start. But it depends on many things, on the paperwork from the customer,
the transfer,
the invoice is wrong, the validation on the pedimento. There's 10 factors, not just our own.
So how easy is it for a Mexican brokers?
Yeah.
To just say, I'll flip it over.
I do that.
But how,
oh, flip it over. You mean like from Laredo to X?
From Laredo to Colombia.
Oh.
It's not common practice.
Because it's a whole different rate, whole different logistics.
Some of you guys that are bigger have both ports on your license.
Yeah, it's not just that.
And your paperwork has the port.
The paperwork you change is the thing is the cost. So you call your customer and say, you know what, you're going to
pay more.
It's a little extra. And what is, what Mr. Lichetti is saying, in order for it to be attractive, you have to reduce all the time and the distance and that extra expense, not just the bridge fee. You know, I mean, in order to, for it to be attractive. And so you would have to hire the Laredo and lower the Columbia in order to kind of compensate and be attractive, and I don't think.
That's why I'm saying.
And then again.
It makes much more sense to see it from a point of view that we're trying to bring more crossings into the morning or whatever, you know, than try to bring from Laredo to Columbia. That's, we're not gonna make it with toll fees. Warehouses, time, et cetera, right? But not with toll fees, I mean.
What about recommending council to hire the people that do the study for the pricing there?
You know, and I would tend to go with the volume, because like you said, that's a bureaucratic process where it's unnecessary. We could do that without having to go ahead and do that approach. But Luis is right. We should wait till the Gloria comes up and see how they go with that as a suggestion, take consideration as an advisory committee. And then maybe even throw in their caveat, you know, hey, reduce the prices and take away DOT during that timeframe as well. Throwing ideas outside the box. And then David, just a process, maybe the reduced volume would increase the volume, because there's more increased volume instead of just thinking we're reducing the price. Considering our capacity that we have right now, the limitation that we have, just thinking outside the box.
And Carlos is not here, but he will be a good opinion on this. If we raise the on the peak hours, the rate,
how he charges,
how we are gonna be charged, and that's gonna be an extra charge. So we better wait for the work rate and.
And you tell him, hey, you cross that 1201, no, but I give you the papers at 11.
Nobody's gonna eat that charge. So maybe we are gonna lower the crossing over there by increasing the rate.
No, but the one thing I know that back in the day, they raised it up, they raised the amount, and they attacked all of us on the Blue Ribbon Committee, all our members that we represent. So that is not even a suggestion.
Especially because we are gonna increase like $10, but then Carlos is gonna say, no, it's gonna take me more time. So it's the $10 on top of this, on top of this. And what happened with the empties? It's, we are paying like a lot more than before.
All right, so we saw two things. We can't raise prices, and it's crazy to flip them 0.5%, about 50%. So there has to be something in between or some incentive that we have to brainstorm to come up with, because it's not going to be a 50% reduction.
But the problem is we are looking into more traffic from 1 hour to another. Do we have any study? How many trailers are we crossing? What is exactly a peak hour in Colombia? Because to me, I don't see a peak hour in Colombia.
Really. The peak hour is not in Colombia. The peak hour is getting to Colombia. Like me, I'm in mile over there by Alamos, San Amos. I go to Colombia. I have to cross like I'm going to World Trade Bridge. So 8 to 12, I'll take, you know, it's free. Colombia, in fact, once you pass Millennium Park, or you're flashing. But to get to Millennium Park, to get to the park, everybody from the south going to Colombia, it gets stuck on the same cluster that takes you to World Trade Bridge on the 2 to 6 p.m. You have to go and then turn right on Mines Road.
What I've heard is that they want to alleviate the traffic during the hours that kids are out of school, school buses are in the area. So within that time frame, they want everything to stay at Columbia and not congest minds when kids are coming out of school, school buses are around, people are getting out of work.
That is so unfathomable. Mm-hmm.
The only thing you could do is,
you can try to stop the biggest industry in the city for that, for school buses and people getting out of work.
That's an infrastructure.
That's
problem.
Crazy. Yeah, that's not our problem. That's a city infrastructure.
That's where we're at. That's why they're like.
That's a bigger problem.
Who's on the school board?
Noah, thank you for your time.
Yes, sorry. We just pinpointed what the issue is.
We can't hear you.
You're muted.
We can't hear you.
We can't hear you.
It reminds me of my dinner time and with my family. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
It was fun. It's great to see you all. Good luck. Thank you. Bye-bye.
No, I mean, I think we're comparing two different things, to different markets and two different variables, very different. I mean, putting down toll fees is not gonna net the extra costs to choose whatever bridge or roll trade or whatnot. So we have to look at other factors.
The options also.
What was the whole purpose of this?
I mean, that's why I'm in.
Motion to move to another item?
Yeah.
You mentioned to wait till they.
When is La Gloria over?
The end of January, February.
End of January. So table for middle of 20.
But he also has to give us some clarity. I still don't understand, what was the purpose for him to bring it down by 15?
It's to attract people.
We already have the business and he's trying to.
It's because we're on two different sides.
Yeah, they're very different.
Yeah, two different end games. They're trying to just bring business, no matter from what. Big times, no big times. We want more, and we have to manipulate or take care of like
issues. Yeah,
maybe bring Dr. Gonzalez there.
They're more desperate for that business than we are. So that's why they're dropping it 50%.
But on the Mexican side, it's more attractive to have that rate reduction, and he's gonna bring some new crossing on the Mexican side, but on the U.S. side it's complicated.
It's north south, it's southbound. Okay.
Yeah. If they do what
north side, it's
50%.
If they do what Mr. Vichel said, I mean, it's really attractive if the cost is running down and it, I mean, because they lowered it, it might still be as costly to get over there.
How much is it?
$250.
Yeah, for $4. For those $6 empties that are obligated to use Colombia, but that's a good benefit.
And he's
doing it wrong. They figured it out. If I was him, I would go pay the Laredo Bridge System $25 per truck and make it free for everybody. Because the state of Nuevo León would make money charging the IVA a part of that. And that's more than $20 a truck on the southbound side. But if you wanted to do something, you come and tell the Laredo Bridge System, Nuevo León will pay all southbound. That's fine. All southbound.
No, but that's why we have a better rating than they do.
that would create, because that's where the money maker is. They want the duties collected, they share with the state of Nuevo León. That's when you compete with Tamaulipas.
All right, so the motion is to
table it
until they
to wait for at least 3 months after the Gloria road is completed to see how the volumes.
The motion is to wait till they
wait 3 months after the road is completed.
You know, and maybe if you could add and have Laredo Bridge System add a study of the crossing reports, maybe include that in there so we can kind of review that.
Is that available?
Yep. Plus money. The amount of trucks that are moved at that time.
Second
by Mr. Gansa.
Your favor.
Any discussion?
No more.
Last item.
Quick report on the World Trade Bridge expansion. The consulting team met with CBP last week. They reviewed the current status of the project development with folks from CBP. They reviewed the value engineering study. They discussed the design revision to shorten the actual bridge and provide longer earth embankment for approach roadway and flare approach roadway to provide better truck viewing alignment. They discussed benefits for adding an overhead sign bridge, a dynamic LED matrix message sign, and CCTV surveillance cameras over both the new and existing bridges. They discussed inclusion of infrastructure for the multi-energy portals, the MEPs, pre-clearance locations within the approach roadway for new bridge to facilities, seamless start of operations, and then the general traffic volumes and increase in the usage of the fast lanes. After that meeting with CBP, they came over to City Hall and met with Mr. Neb and pretty much briefed him on all this information that they had discussed with CBP. This was the initial first meeting with Mr. Neb, even though he's aware of the project, he was in the Washington trip, but still they formally advised him of where we stand with the NEPA process and the presidential permit process. Last week, Thursday, I received an email from the folks on the Tamaulipas side advising Sid that they had concluded the bidding process and that they were ready to start working on the survey, so which is great. So that we had already previously met. They didn't have a consultant on board, now they do. So this week they were supposed to do some surveying on the Mexican side, and Sid was going to bring his crew to do some surveying on the US side, and then they're going to get together and do it jointly. So the project is moving forward. We're not waiting for the presidential permit. I mean, the project is moving forward. I have all faith that we will receive the presidential permit, but the engineering and the NEPA process is ongoing. So that's kind of where we stand with the project. So it's moving forward full force.
Good. Okay. Are you going to talk about the U-turns? That's it? No U-turn?
I gave you all the stats. Old news. They're there.
Still there.
We are still working on communicating with these customers, but I mean, it's still there. Not as bad as what it was originally. Mm-hmm. But staff continues to work with our customers.
We got four customers with 5 and 4. Like every week they have one. Mm-hmm. And four customers. Yeah, one guy with 7 deals. That's at the end there. He lost money.
The customers with just one in travel decreased, which is good. So it's those repeaters. But staff continues to work.
Well, the big question is, you know, hope this money is, I'm guessing it's sitting in a pile reserved for whatever the.
Out of what we generate, half stays a bridge to operate, pay debt service. We have a 15% fund balance requirement that we must meet. Everything in excess, the other 50% goes to general fund. And as we did last year, all the years, if we exceed our budget, then that extra revenue and any expense that we don't use, we don't spend 100% of our budget. All of that, after all the calculations are done, then it flows into the capital improvement fund.
Okay, well, at least capital improvement is good. But we could always, if we come up with an idea that the bridge needs something, capital is $300,000 to $400,000, we could always sell them, hey, we gave you the $300,000 here.
I do that every budget cycle.
Yeah, that's good. But in case something comes up, we have $300,000.
Property owner, so they have embraced the property tax.
In dollar amount, what do we normally give to the general fund every year?
Last year, we generated $79.5 million. So we keep half, they get half. And everything else extra,
it's a big
$40 plus.
Good. And do you know what today's general fund balance is?
I don't have that number, but you can probably get
City normally carries over every year.
You can probably get it through the city website, okay. The budgeting numbers. I don't have that number today, but if not, I can get it for you to share.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Wong, for your report.
Thank you, Melvin.
Next item, other business.
Move to adjourn.
And then schedule the next meeting. We go on December or we go to January?
January.
So we have January 16th, 17th, or 18th.
Is there any pressing business that needs to be discussed for December? I think that should be the question first. If not, we could
move on to January.
What we're doing right now is interviewing everybody. We have to interview the Mexican.
What about January? We asked for the Mexican side to.
And then again.
It gets us closer.
Can we set up a meeting with them to explain to them what we need so they won't come here and say, oh, we don't know, but we'll take it back and come back? Can we?
What?
What we're gonna ask them so they can come back? O sea, informarle de qué es. La norma, llamarlos a la junta que lleguen, they're gonna come. No, don't let the Mexican, no, a la aduana.
La aduana de Colombia.
A ellos, a explicarles with a month ahead or 3 months, hey, we're gonna ask, can you come up with numbers? I don't know what your flaws are. What do you guys think you need? How can we help? But tell them in advance, not use this meeting to tell them and they're gonna come and be like, okay, we'll take note and come back.
Okay. The invitation, we can tell them all we need.
Right, but keep in mind, this month's meeting, we had the folks from Anam report on when the system failed. And we agreed that we were gonna set up a meeting to talk about an agreement and a protocol. So that the communication is there, even though we do have it, but if not a unified communication. So we're pending that meeting as well, just with CBP, with Anam and stakeholders, everybody, so that we can start drafting that contingency plan in writing so that everybody knows what's gonna happen when something happens.
The system goes down.
That's normally what we experience.
But in that last meeting, didn't we also set up a subcommittee apart from this committee to do that?
It was pretty much everybody. It's pretty much everybody. Yeah.
We got by proposal 17th of January.
17th of January?
What about the 17th? I'm sorry.
Sunday.
When?
Or 16th of
January. Okay, January, keep in mind. January, I'm gonna excuse myself from that meeting. I'm out of town on the.
Yeah, the 15th.
By the way, it's my birthday. You can send me happy birthday.
So the city council meeting is on the 16th of January. And keep in mind, we use council chamber.
Well, we do the morning, we do morning session.
Is it better the week before or we push it early?
Cause of.
If you're gonna might.
They don't start.
All right, so the 23rd.
Let's try not. Let's try not to do Tuesdays because we will be in the same situation we're in right now. The city manager has his staff meeting.
24th, Wednesday?
Wednesdays are good. If it's okay, any Wednesday is good. If you.
Want to do the 17th then or?
That week, you prefer Wednesday or Thursday?
Wednesday.
Wednesday.
Oh, yeah, that's 24th. So the. There's a LEDC meeting on the.
No, just the one day.
The 17th?
The 16th is bad for me.
Oh, the 16th is bad.
Some of the other LEDC.
The 17th is good or not?
17, okay. It was bad for somebody. I forget who it was.
Monica?
Oh, it's a birthday.
Oh, we'll have a cake.
She will be.
I can take lunch invitation next week. The following week. And before.
You won't be here 17, 18?
At 18?
I'm not here from the 16th to the 22nd.
And I'm out on the 24th. But on the 24th, it's only me.
We'll do the 17th. If not, we're gonna lose more people. The 17th, 10 a.m. All right, council chambers. Or as the motion to.
No, quick, it's just, I know with Gene, a couple of meetings ago, and I don't think we attended that meeting, but you brought up the tornado. Actually, you want to bring that up now?
Yeah, I can do it in 15 seconds. The tomato suspension, there'll be a significant increase in the tariffs on imported tomatoes from Mexico if the desires from the Florida Tomatoes Association in their petition to the U.S. Commerce Department gets accepted. There are 33 bipartisan members of Congress that are against changing the current status. There are 300 businesses and organizations and municipal governments that have signed a letter, like the BTA and the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. There's a lot of great advocacy and pressure to keep everything in status quo. There's no official date or cadence on when the U.S. Commerce Department will make a ruling. It may just be ignored forever.
But I'll keep my finger on the pulse and continue to report if there's any change.
I attached the letter from IBC.
Yes, yes, thank you.
And with the minute.
Motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second. Every second in favor and.
Thank you.
And thank you.